Disco is alive and well in the Warhammer universe. Who knew? Ariel the Mage Queen just got back from the Fleetwood Mac concert, rocking a Karen hairstyle straight out of the 70s, and the Beastmen are all up in her grill. So the Sisters of Twilight and their forest dragon Seth and Har are about to rain down an ungodly freaky firestorm on the Cloven Ones, with a little bit of help from the Lost Sylvan Knights, a ghostly regiment of Great Stags, the newest monstrous cavalry unit in Total War Warhammer 2. We've got Ice Queen Dryads, bunch of new units on display, and Kazrak One-Eye with a significant rework that should make him a much more viable pick in multiplayer and probably campaign as well. It's one of the oldest Warhammer rivalries here, butting heads and trading blows in the essence of chaos. Let's see how they stack up. So, I am playing as the Heralds of Ariel in this battle with the Sisters of Twilight, leading the way on their unique Sky Serpent. And they are scary together. Seth and Har's tenacity gives them a nice boost in melee once they drop below half HP. Arahan's Talon of Dusk is an anti-infantry split shot that will ravage blobs of lightly armored chaff. Talon of Dawn is a bonus versus large armor-sundering bow wielded by Nystra, and yes, they do indeed have their conjoined Destiny heal. It takes 30 seconds to activate, but can get them back almost 2,000 HP when the timer's over. Trana Forest Dragon, with high physical resistance, can easily make the difference in battle, so they have a lot of ways to influence engagements, switching between their fire modes, charging into melee, unleashing soporific breaths, shooting stuff with their armor-piercing magic missiles. They're super good, and the dragon has a unique skin as well, which is always nice. Gives those special mounts some unique visual flair. Hawk Riders got buffed substantially in the Twisted and the Twilight. They now have fire while moving and 360-degree fire arse, which means they don't become useless the second something decides to chase them down, and Ariel the Mage Queen has arrived in all her splendor. A bullet with butterfly wings, she has a fantastic selection of spells and unique abilities, but you're paying for it because she can easily run you over 2,500 gold. Apotheosis, Tempest, and Soul Stealer as her spells for this one. Tempest in case harpies try to dive into my non-existent back line, and Strawberry Wine gives her a bound spell regrowth, so healing for the dragon or for my Lost Sylvan Knights. Over here we have the Wraiths of the Frozen Heart, a dryad unit from Athelwith, some of the few spirits that can be roused from their slumber in that snowy realm. Pretty crazy stat line on them actually, 50 melee attack with Frostbite Frenzy and almost 40 weapon strength, and we're looking at the terror-causing stags over here. The Lost Sylvan Knights that cost a whopping 2,000 Warhammer bucks with 75% physical resistance, silver shields, and a truly brutal stat line. They are not actually ethereal, so they do not crumble, and they are not treated like undead, but they bear many hallmarks of a unit like Hexwraiths all the same. Ghostly Monstrous Cav with 76 charge bonus, almost 70 weapon strength is awesome, but very dangerous if the Beastmen decide to bring the Sons of Goros. Thankfully, they did not. So, for Janet on occasion and the Beastmen, very wide build here. Swarm the field with bodies, essentially, just tie up their ranged options. But Kazrak has a new toy. His Dark Mail is now a constant 20% ward save when he's in melee, making him much more durable. And his Whip Scourge now gives him huge combat bonuses, including 32 bonus versus infantry, which should make him an infantry blender with very few equals in Mortal Empires when he's on his chariot. But he might end up being a solid foot option as well, because when he's on foot, with that ward save, 32 bonus versus infantry, gonna be hard to kill, and he'll actually be dishing out some pretty serious damage too. He was not a good footlord on previous patches, but now he might be. There's a Bray Shaman of the Lore of Wild with Traitorkin and Viletide and a bunch of Warp Spawn piggies by his side, and I realized pretty much at the start of the match, my infantry is just gonna die. There isn't actually much I can do about it. With the Chariots and the Razor Gores backing up all those Beastmen, the Dryads and Eternal Guard should be able to last like all of 5 seconds before they get completely run over. But a good way to help them last a teeny bit longer is to drop the Distraction card effects into the Horde. So the Sisters drop feet first into Hell, soak up a ton of attention, and the Lost Sylvan Knights can then spring their Vanguard ambush from the woods. They were hidden completely, they're super fast, they're at 95 speed, which is crazy, especially for a Monstrous Cav unit. They close the gap, and they're in and amongst the enemy Centaurs almost immediately. But I wanted to get Ariel over here to cast a big Soul Sealer on that blob that's forming around Seth and Har. Fortunately, there's a lot of stuff in her way, and it's harder for single entities to push through blocks of infantry now, whether it be your own or your enemies. Yeah, my right flank is not going well. The branch wraiths of Athelwith will be run over pretty quickly, so I pretty much have to rely on my single entities and my terror-causing cav. Thankfully, I have some very good ones on the field right now. Ariel causes terror, has 20% physical resistance, and she's decent in melee too. She got in range for the Soul Stealer, and it's gonna hit everything on this side of the battlefield, but Genin on occasion will counter with a Vile Tide, which will do a pretty decent amount of damage to a unit with zero armor. I'll be very curious to see how the meta shakes out between these two races, especially in regards to the Lost Sylvan Knights. They're a unit that, in theory, absolutely demolishes the vast majority of the Beastmen roster. They might make the Sons of Goros and their magic attacks a necessity for the Beastmen, but that in turn would make the Great Stag units an incredibly risky pick. And of course, there's still the Lore of Death, where Spirit Leeches or Bunas will absolutely wreck their day. So they've had an amazing start for me so far, have broken that entire flank, and not just broken it, shattered it completely, killed off four full units of highly mobile Beastmen units. But now it's time to collapse into the center around Ariel and deal with the Bray Shaman and hopefully Khazrak One-Eye himself. So best way to do that for me, get rid of the Ungor Raiders because they're actually a relatively large threat. And when you get them in big blocks and tie down the sisters, focus fire from the little goat dudes can bring down even the mightiest of titans. So quick charge from the Lost Sylvan Knights while Khazrak happily munches and crunches my Eternal Guard over on the other flank will be just what the doctor ordered. My right flank can't hold it any longer, they're so weak. They're just breaking all over the field right now, and we're throwing everything into the breaches that we can, trying to stem the tide. Even the Hawk Riders are getting in on the action, pitting the Centaurs in place for a juicy, soporific breath from Seth and Har. It's a risky play, though. Hawk Riders could fire from the safety of the skies with relative impunity, so if they go down, all my range play besides the Sisters is gone. So far, played a bit of a game of cat and mouse with the Great Stags, healing them up with Berry Wine and Apotheosis while the Bray Shaman lowers their speed with Traitorkin and Vile Tides them anytime they commit. And that was a nice breath attack, killed off a bunch of the cavalry, and the Great Stags are close to full HP with 1300 health going their way from that Berry Wine and about 480 or so every time Apotheosis lands. They're still in good shape for now, but they'll be close to that healing cap, and they have a long way to go, a lot more work left to do. Terror routes on this side should certainly help, but like I said, my infantry was not going to be able to hold out, and quickly, the Dryads and Eternal Guard were cleaned up by the Beastmen, who now have a huge numbers advantage. But I went for a very tall, very top-heavy type of build, so Seth and Har, the Sisters of Twilight, and Ariel have a lot of weight on their shoulders, and up to this point, they have carried it admirably. Now, one of the coolest things about the Sisters of Twilight, especially when they're mounted on their Forest Dragon, obviously they're going to be a very strong melee combatant. But when you switch over to that Talon of Dusk, that bonus versus infantry split shot, you can ravage blobs of lightly armored chaff. It is amazing the DPS they can unleash, and they'll be firing the entire time. They're like Luthor Harkin, firing into melee while they're doing it. But unlike Luthor Harkin, it's not a single shot pistol, it's a multi-shot wave clear type of bow. And it has been amazing for clearing out Ungor so far. Another Traitorkin hitting my Great Stags, Lost Sylvan Knights, realizing they're in a pretty precarious position. And now the mass from the Beastmen. Look at the Chariots and the Centaurs tying up half of that unit who have now been caught up and cannot move away from the engagement. That's a problem. Hawk Riders have not been used amazingly. I think it was a good idea to go in and get rid of some of the Ungor Raiders, but I didn't pull them out in time, and they got destroyed by the Centaurs, and now I don't have a lot of them left, which means in the late game, my range potential is gonna be pretty minimal. Can't really do a lot of skirmishing from on high anymore. Trying to keep the Great Stags alive with Apotheosis and that 480 HP heal, good charge coming into the Warhounds, but you can see half of this unit is still stuck with the Beastmen, and that is one of the changes that came in this DLC and in this update. You cannot pull through blocks of tightly packed infantry anywhere near as easily anymore. It is true for single entities as well. So, Ariel fully surrounded now. She's in a precarious position too. A little bit of support from the Hawk Riders firing in, but not too many models left on them. And Seth and Har and the Sisters of Twilight dealing with all the Ungor Raiders in the back of the map, trying to make sure they can't come in the late game and deal some huge damage to Ariel or the dragon itself. Now, I'm trying to pull out of these Ungor herd, and again, we are going to see the changes to mass here. I don't know if I force path enough, so I can't say with any degree of certainty that that is a perfect representation of the changes to mass, but one thing I do know is that in the last patch, getting out of there would be no issue whatsoever, and at the moment, they're having a much harder time pulling through and escaping. The Great Stags are on life support at this point. They have not routed off because they have amazing leadership, just terror routed some Centaurs. Nero the Mage Queen just cast Apotheosis on herself, and she is going to try to force a blob around her so the Forest Dragon can come over and maybe do some great shooting into the melee blob with that Talon of Dusk, and maybe with a couple of Soporific Breaths as well. She also has some decent mobility. She won't be able to run away from Kazrak, but she can escape from the infantry. And yeah, look at that. Sisters are low after the little escapade with a bunch of Ungor Raiders and Spearmen. But they're up to 280 kills, which is insane. The DPS they've unleashed this battle has been incredibly impressive. They've killed off some important units, and now Ariel trying to alley-oop it for a Soporific Breath attack on Kazrak. Definitely dodged by Janet on occasion. Well played from him. And he takes no damage from that whatsoever. Which means only one more breath attack left. And missing that one hurts a lot. Balance bar is in favor of the Beastmen right now. All they have left is Ariel the Mage Queen and Seth and Har riding the Sisters of Twilight. Pretty sure it's the other way around, but might be a good Rule 34 introduction. We'll see. But yeah, Ariel is going off in melee combat right now, unleashing her Darts of Doom, her Wand of Witch Elm, and the Acorns of the Oak of Ages. And even though they have a full surround off, vines and dwellers below reaching up from the ground, tearing them apart. Lisa, they're tearing me apart. And she's holding back an entire horde by herself. She's doing a fantastic job for me at the moment and not taking too much damage either. But the real question here is, can we get rid of Kazrak One-Eye? If the One-Eye dies, if his chariot is exploded and the dragon managed to kill him off, the rest of the Bray Herd will surely follow suit. But he's got that 20% ward save whenever he's in melee, and the Forest Dragon is dropping low too. Might not have a lot of heals left to go their way either. I think Ariel the Mage Queen has popped 2 Soul Stealers and quite a few Apotheosis already, so her Winds of Magic, even with Greater Arcane Conduit, probably dropping pretty low at this point. And you can see, the dragon went after the piggies. That was the top priority besides Kazrak himself. They have the mass and the armor piercing to pin down Seth and Har and potentially kill off these Sisters of Twilight. So when they're isolated like that, you gotta go after them. You gotta make sure they are gone for good. Here comes Kazrak. Ariel the Mage Queen still fighting out. This time she got knocked down. A regal, majestic Karen dropped low by the evil Brayherds. And the Forest Dragon might want to make his way over real quick because she's dropping extremely low and might not have enough Winds of Magic for her final Soul Stealer. Now, one thing I did not do well this game, and you might have noticed it already, I kept Fire at Will on for most of the battle, and that led to a lot of wasted shots, especially with the Talon of Dawn, the Bones vs. Large variant. So I think I used the Bones vs. Infantry Split Shot quite well. I'm doing so now. It's doing a ton of damage to the horde that's conglomerated around our Mage Queen, but the single shot variant, definitely I'd say 8 or so shots wasted pretty badly. Big Soporific Breath raining down. This one dealt about 500, 600 damage. Ward save actually helped him tremendously there. Would have dealt even more because there's a pretty good one directly over the top, vertical, straight down. But that cleared out the rest of the infantry. The Regiment of Renown trying to come in to help Kazrak, but super low at this point. Nice little armor-piercing shot coming in from the Magic Missile. And the Forest Dragon lands. This might be the end for Kazrak One-Eye, and it might be a comeback for the Sisters of Twilight and the Heralds of Ariel. Mass Route coming in, Terror Route coming in, and the Bray Herd is dealt with. But at what cost? Almost nothing remains of the Wood Elves army, and look at that eye-watering amount of kills with the Sisters and that damage value, which to this point is the highest I've seen on both damage dealt and damage value for any Lord or any unit on this DLC. That is crazy what they were able to do that game, because they didn't just clear out a bunch of chaff and a bunch of fodder. They killed off Centaurs, they killed off Razor Gores, and they killed off Kazrak One-Eye. They did amazing for me that game, and I am pretty sure they are going to be a powerful Lord in Total War Warhammer 2 multiplayer. And in campaign as well. You'll be seeing plenty of that soon. Ariel was fantastic for me that game, and so were the Lost Sylvan Knights. Almost 150 kills. Their high physical resistance and terror making a pretty large impact for me, but again, they are a very dangerous unit to bring because if the Sons of Goros or Lore of Death are brought, and they might be a very common pick now that the Lost Sylvan Knights are a unit, well, they can lose a lot of their value extremely quickly, and there's not a whole lot you can do about it. But with Apotheosis and Berry Wine supported from Ariel, they did great for me. Loved using them, and I love the Monstrous Great Stags. They are a super cool cav unit. You'll be seeing them a lot too. Ariel herself is a force. She's great in melee. She was extremely tanky there. I was surprised how difficult it was for Khazrak to actually deal damage to her. Might have been getting blocked a little bit by his own infantry when he's trying to cycle charge. So she might have lived a little bit longer than she normally would be able to. But yeah, as a support caster, she was great. And Khazrak One-Eye, also, I love the rework for him. The bonus for infantry from Scourge and the constant ward save both are nice buffs for him. And we might be seeing him a lot more on the battlefields of Total War Warhammer 2. Hope you guys enjoyed that game. See you in the next one. Peace out.